Planning board is now in session. Good evening, everyone. First item on the agenda is 0 Furman Ave, request for extension of major site plan approval. Start off with the town planner, and then we'll go to council.
Okay, this particular item is in response to a major site plan approval that had been approved last year and went through the one-year cycle, and now they're requesting an extension, an additional one-year extension for a major site plan approval, 0 Furman Ave. The applicant submitted a request for that extension, which would bring it to actually expiring February 25th of 2018, at which time, if no action's taken, you'd have to apply again for a major site plan approval.
Right.
Okay.
Yes.
Yes.
So the time frame was February 25th. Our next meeting was, regular meeting was gonna be February 27th, so we inserted this meeting to make sure that we were able to handle this within the 1 year.
We very much appreciate that. Thank you for the courtesy.
Good evening, council.
Good evening, Mr. Chair.
Introduce yourself and tell us why you're here.
Yes, for the record, I'm Catherine Garahan from the law firm of Bowditch and Dewey, and I represent Normandy Real Estate Partners, which is the owner of the property at 0 Furman Avenue, which, as probably most of you know, is part of a property that also includes 15 and 16 Pleasant Street Connector in Framingham. So overall, it's an eight and a half acre parcel, with about 4.4 of those acres being in Southborough. And the proposed project, which was first approved back in 2014, would have a renovated building on the parcel, of which there would be 8,000 new square footage in Southborough. The existing building's about 93,000 square feet, and the approval was to add 73,000 square feet to that, so for a total of 156,000 square feet for an office building that straddles the two towns. And then the approval also included adding 142 parking spaces for a maximum of 528 spaces, and those spaces being phased in depending on who the tenant is and what the needs are. So they would not be built out unless they were needed. The applicant, unfortunately, has faced some really tough market conditions, particularly with the office market has been soft in the area, which people are probably aware. The applicant is trying to be as aggressive as it can. It was able to get the site on the Mass Ready 100 online site of Mass Econ, which has permit ready sites to try to advertise to people moving into the area or relocating in the area that these sites are meet certain needs, and this project qualified, so there's hope that that will be helpful in attracting quality tenants to the site. The applicant was able to start some of the renovation interior work, some of the work that they could do without knowing who the tenant would be, but they're at a bit of a standstill until they've located a tenant. They've had some good near misses, a big pharma company recently that ended up deciding to go somewhere else, so they're still very hopeful that the right tenant will show up. And they put a lot of money and time into this project, as you know. As Ms. Quinn said, the present site plan approval was granted 1 year ago, which was a renewal of the original approval from 2014, and this is the 1 year extension that we're allowed to request under the bylaw. So we're respectfully requesting that you consider extending this, and you just so you're lower. You also had a lower impact development permit approved, and that doesn't expire until April of 2018. So this extension would bring the approval somewhat in line with that approval.
So. Very good, thank you. I'll open up to the planning board. Mr. Jenks.
Where are you with Framingham on this?
So Framingham's permitting is a little, they have a little different timeframes than Southborough. So they're, they don't have a special permit expiring right now. Let's see if I can tell you where they're. We do have in both towns, I should mention, conservation permitting that's expiring, and we have requests into both towns to extend that. Let me take a second and tell you where the Framingham, Framingham South site plan review and special permits expire in March of 2018. So that would be about the same time your lower impact yeah. development permit expires.
Would we make an approval subject to other approvals, or just let it stand on its own?
I think it would be on its own, Phil. We throughout the first site plan, which took a while, the Southborough town planner and the Framingham town planner worked together.
Yes.
And it was kind of a parallel track. And at one time it was like, well, who's going to approve it first?
Right.
But then there was a comfort level, and both towns eventually approved everything, and then the extension, and then that ran out, and then the reapplication of the site plan was much a much quicker process because nothing changed.
Nothing changed.
Nothing
right.
had changed on either side. Mr. Stein.
So this is technically the third extension
yes.
that your client is seeking from us.
Right.
You had said that the site has certain needs currently in your discussion.
I said, I'm not sure that's what I
well,
said.
What's the
I might
current
have said
disposition of
tenant
the site?
Needs. I might have said tenant, depending on what the tenant needs. So,
okay.
So say if a tenant, you know, had a certain level of employees, they might need to build out all of the parking spaces. But if it was a
right.
tenant with less, then the agreement with the two towns was that we wouldn't build out more than we needed, you know, because of the proximity to wetlands. And
Has this property been sitting completely vacant since 2013?
Except for the work that the owner has been doing. Yes, there's been no tenant in it. Yeah.
So,
but it's been being prepared for the use.
And if I understand your process correctly, you're trying to attract tenants.
Yes.
And then the work will be done to what the tenant needs.
A build to suit. It was the, you know, and as time goes on, there it may be that they make a different decision around that, but the priority was to make it as attractive as it could to someone that they could build it the way they wanted it. You know, they could build it out the way they wanted it.
So I had abstained from the vote a year ago because I really didn't feel comfortable approving a site plan that I hadn't been a part of the initial review of back in 2013. I wasn't on the planning board at that time. And it's only because I am so pro-business for Southborough and such a proponent for economic development in Southborough that I am willing to, in the absence of Mr. Mills, be the third vote you would need to extend. But rest assured, this is your third extension in front of this board. This is the last one. If your client doesn't action this in the next 12 months and this expires again, you come back to us for another extension, I'm going to vote no, just to be clear. Because I'm not comfortable approving something that I didn't review in the first place. But I take you at your word that this is a lot with a lot of potential that's going to attract a tenant. And I want to make things work from a business perspective for Southborough. So on that basis, I'm willing to support your petition at this time, but not in the future. Thanks.
Mrs. Luttrell.
I have no questions.
Back to Mr. Jenks.
Is the building for sale?
It could be if the right person wanted to buy it. That's kind of just their standard they intend to own it and operate it, but if somebody wanted to buy it, that's, they wouldn't not consider the offer, so.
What do you mean by the right person wanted to buy it?
Well, not the right person, but I mean the right situation. If they can, they continue to have trouble marketing it to a tenant and someone made an offer that made sense, then they would consider it.
Okay.
So that hasn't really been the push, but yeah.
Help me with this one, Council.
Yeah.
If the board votes to grant this extension, we would be sending the town clerk a letter indicating that. And then that would start a, I guess, a 20-day appeal period. Does that sound right?
That would start the site plan review, would start the, right, that would be the, just to make sure it didn't, should start the 20-day, which would be.
It'd be 20 days
right,
after
it would, we ran into this last year, I think, too, that there would be a, that there was a little bit of a gap between the expiration of this and the 20-day appeal period. So it's one of those situations that's at the applicant's risk.
So if the clerk, today's the 13th, let's say the clerk signs it, stamps it, and starts the 20-day appeal period clock ticking tomorrow, which is the 14th, and then we would be granting an extension from February 25th.
Right.
So the 20-day appeal period for whatever action the board, if the board took this action tonight, would end after the new period
right.
began.
Yeah, it's the applicant's risk during that period. But the approval would go back to the 25th if no appeal takes place.
Okay.
So.
And then how does this get filed? Does anything get filed at the Registry of Deeds?
Yes.
What is that?
Your whole decision gets recorded. So attached to your... the letter before you, you can see it has the recording information for the decision itself. So we would record the extension, you know, and it would get indexed back to the decision, so.
Okay.
Yeah.
Did you have any questions of us?
Don't think so, no.
Open it up to the public then. Anybody, questions and comments relative to Zero Furman Ave? So we would entertain a motion to grant the extension. Mr. Jenks.
Mr. Chairman, I move that the Planning Board grants the requested extension of the major site plan approval for Zero Furman Ave in Southborough to February 25th, 2018. As allowed by Section 174.10F of the Southborough Zoning Code.
Second.
Motion's been made and seconded. Any discussion? All in favor? Very good. 4-0.
Thank you.
Best of luck.
Thank you very much.
Did you want to? Was what I showed you okay?
It looked good to me.
You want to take it?
Yeah. Sure.
And yes. I may be signing this tonight, but if you want to recommend any changes, you can do that before you leave, or just call Karina tomorrow, and we'll see what we can do as far as that before we take it to the clerk.
Thank you very much.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, everyone.
Thanks. Next item on the agenda is a vote to establish the Adaptive Reuse of Historic Buildings Bylaw Subcommittee. Prior to tonight, there was a working group which the Planning Board wants to transition into a subcommittee to finish its business relative to the Adaptive Reuse of Historic Buildings Bylaw. You want add anything to that, Karina?
No, that covers it.
Any questions, comments? I'll take it down the board. Mr. Jenks?
No questions.
Mr. Stein?
Who's the Planning Board representative on the subcommittee?
Ms. Luttrell.
Okay.
No questions.
Do you, so we would, I guess the motion would be to establish this subcommittee whose members would be the current working group members. If the vote carries, then the working group would no longer exist as a working group. It would exist as a subcommittee. You have that list?
Of people?
No, the there was a list of things that was in that.
The tasks?
Yes.
I can go grab it.
Okay.
All right.
Mr. Jenks.
Is the reason for doing this that the working group cannot finish the zoning bylaw?
The working group, the work that the working group is doing was reviewed by the town clerk and felt that the working group needed to meet in public session because it was there were three triggers that would require that working group to post agendas and meet in public session. So
I think that might be easier too.
It was decided that for clarity, the working group would transition to something called a subcommittee, and then that subcommittee would what we're being asked to do tonight is to take the membership of that working group and transition it to a subcommittee, which would then be subject to, you know, the open meeting law, posting of agenda, and minutes, and so on. So, that's what we're going to do tonight. Yeah, those are the triggers. If anybody's interested in those, I can read those. And then you had an email. Karina, you had that email that I read today that said once the subcommittee is created, they must, one of the things was to elect a chairman.
Yes, right here.
That in here?
This is the task.
Oh, okay, right in front of me. So, did I answer your question, Phil?
Not exactly. Does that imply that a group called a working group is not subject to open meeting law?
No, we could still call it a working group. The the reason to change it to a subcommittee would be to, just to...
differentiate.
Kind of like differentiate that a change has been made between what was, what the group was doing before and how the group will perform once they're a subcommittee. They could still be called a working group. They originally could have been called a subcommittee. The Attorney General's office has helped us through the town clerk, and you can, it's a public body. That's the, you know, the open meeting law applies to a public body. Is defined as a multiple board, multiple member board, commission, committee, or subcommittee within the executive or legislative branch, or within any county, district, city, region, or town, however created, elected, appointed, or otherwise constituted, established to serve a public purpose.
Is there a term to this? Do we know when they're through and what happens when their work is complete?
That's an excellent question.
There are stipulations.
The town planner has sent to the current working group, if the planning board establishes this subcommittee, then there's a list of five things that the new subcommittee would be expected to do, one of which is to establish its term when the subcommittee will expire. That's one of the items. If you want, I'll go through these five.
I would respectfully think that those things ought to be established before a committee is created. We have to know what they're doing, when it ends, how we know when their business is complete. I think this is putting the cart before the horse, so to speak.
So, Mr. Chairman, it seems to me like this working group is sort of up against a time crunch, because the work needs to be completed for April town meeting. And in my opinion, anything that we can do to add transparency, maybe, you know, even lend more credibility to the effort, to the substance of the bylaw itself, I think would be a positive. So I'm willing to support this and sort of lend, you know, the trust and the delegated authority of the subcommittee to establish what Mr. Jenks is concerned about within their time frame, within their own parameters, and just move this thing forward so we can be ready with a bylaw for April. So I'd be willing to make the motion at this point if anybody else, unless.
I'd like to hear from Mrs. Luttrell.
The work product of the working group we've discussed. I think we've had one public hearing and a continued public hearing. So what the work that we've been doing, I think, is well known and out there. I think there was more. The town clerk's office got additional information that we needed to follow these procedures, and we're trying to follow those procedures.
So, Mr. Chairman, I'd like to make a motion.
Oh, could I just, sorry, Jesse. Let's see if we can address what Phil was concerned with, which is the date that the
subcommittee would expire.
When the subcommittee would expire. Do you, one of these items here that we sent to you, Michael and Joe, and David, did you get one, Bonnie? Did you get a copy of this? No. It just went out on Friday. But anyways, it says here, you know, the subcommittee, if these actions take place, which includes the determination of the expiration of the subcommittee, this email indicates that you would determine that. But if Mr. Jenks, I think he might have a point here, and if we can get that done, that might help clear it up. But it says here, the subcommittee could then meet no earlier than Thursday the 16th, which is a couple days from now, but should try to schedule no later than Wednesday the 22nd so that we can have a final draft reviewed by town council one last time. So, as Mr. Stein said, there is a bit of a time crunch here, but this is going to go to the Springtown meeting. Mm-hmm. So, would it be safe to have your subcommittee expire some point after that, like June 1st or June 30th, the end of fiscal year?
If the town meeting does not vote the new zoning proposal in, does the subcommittee end?
I think if we allow, if the expiration date of the subcommittee goes beyond that vote, then they're still in business until the date that we say the subcommittee expires, which would allow them to work on whatever caused the warrant article to fail.
So,
and of course, I think would be within our rules to either extend their expiration date or create a new subcommittee.
So what date are you proposing?
June 30th.
And how many members are on this?
Can I name the members?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, okay. Well, Mimi Luttrell, and I'm on it, and David Perry, Michael Weishin, and Bill Sines from the ADA committee.
Joe Hubley.
Oh, and Joe Hubley, too. Sorry. See you behind there. And basically, we have to do this in order to meet open meeting law, which we just found out last week.
That's the part that's a mystery to me, but it's a good committee. It's a good group. I'd prefer a little more formality to establishing it, but I'll support it as is.
So, Mr. Stein, your motion would then include that expiration date. Mr. Stein.
I'd like to make a motion that the planning board establish an adaptive reuse of historic buildings bylaw subcommittee consisting of the membership of the current working group with a term to expire June 30th, 2017.
Second.
Motion's been made and seconded. Discussion, Mr. Perry. Evening, David.
Good evening. Is this on? Is
yep.
that on? No, it's just a suggestion. You know, Phil, I think you're doing a very good thing. I think we have to be completely open about it. I mean, we've done a lot of work, and it's moved light years ahead. But I just think that, you know, you have a very good point. It may not pass at this year's term meeting, you know, before, just because we've left out a comma or a period. So would it not make sense, to, Mr. Mainboard Member, to, you know, to have the committee continue until such time as the proposed bylaw is adopted, I mean, which would allow us to continue through the summer. If it passes in April, then we end in April. You see what I'm getting at? I don't know quite how to word it, but anyway, it's just a suggestion.
David, I'd agree with that if we added the wording or as otherwise terminated by the planning board.
Okay.
So just so that if it didn't pass and it looked like it was going to go on forever, we may want to take a new route.
So the motion as amended, Mr. Chairman?
I'm not sure. How is that any different than the way we had it before, which is if it doesn't pass at any time before, during, or after the warrant goes before the town meeting, the planning board has the authority to terminate the subcommittee or to let it expire on June 30th.
So we can always vote to extend.
And we can vote to extend.
So does that address your concern? Yeah.
I think it gives us more flexibility because whatever happens at town meeting, as Mr. Jenks just said, it might cause a slight difference in direction that we can't anticipate. So I think the original motion gives us the most flexibility.
Yep. After that thought, I agree. And we'll...
So the original motion is... Bonnie. Good evening.
Good evening. I'm sorry to hold you up. This is a subcommittee. Are you required now to get sworn in?
Yep.
As such?
Yep. I believe that's the case.
Okay. So remind everybody.
We'll let the town clerk take care of that. Right. Yeah.
So we'll just leave the motion as is then with the term to expire June 30th. Because we can always extend it if we want to.
Motion's been made by Mr. Stein. It was seconded by Mrs. Luttrell. Any more discussion? All in favor? 4-0. Thank you. Next item on the agenda is a continuation of the public hearing for the draft historic reuse bylaw. First two public hearings, first one was opened on January 9th, was continued to February 3rd, and then continued again to tonight. Call on the town planner to update us on what's been going on in that time frame.
The working group that was formed prior to all this other information, we met two times since the public hearing was opened in January, I believe, and in both times we made very good progress on coming up with a adaptive reuse for historic buildings bylaw document. We reworked it a couple times with a lot of input from Mr. Perry and Sam Stivers and Mrs. Luttrell, and we feel we've got a document that's very close to probably like 90-95% done. In addition, we've sent this to town council, who reviewed it and provided us with some response comments today, which we'll be addressing at our next subcommittee meeting, which we'll be holding on next week, February 21st, I believe. Yeah, Tuesday, I'm sorry. Tuesday, next Tuesday, right after the holiday, we'll be meeting at 4 p.m. at the Historic Museum to finalize any of our working group comments and then resubmit it to Town Council for final approval and final legal verbiage so that we can have it prepared in final draft for the Planning Board meeting on the 27th. And that's the goal. So then we'll be ready to have it for the an article for the warrant on the 6th of March.
Question. Has the legal opinion that we received today from Town Council been shared with all the members of the working group at this point?
Yes, I believe this afternoon we emailed it out not only to the Planning Board members, but also the working group, soon to be subcommittee. Well, already subcommittee. Oh, yeah, you have to get sworn in first.
So I'll open it up to the planning board. Any questions or comments, Mrs. Luttrell? We just received this today, so. But I think the, well, go ahead.
I think what the subcommittee was looking to the planning board for was advice on the site plan review process. Whether we should just reference our current site plan or list specific criteria for this bylaw. I think that was one of the outstanding questions we had.
It's on the last page. What's that S3 mean? Does anybody know what that S3 is?
That might be from the tracking in Word software. Sometimes if you put something in and...
So ML2 is part of the tracking software? ML1.
Yeah, this is a draft that shows the changes in line with the document. Usually you'll have bubbles on the right side, but the print gets too small. So in order to just be very clear what we changed from the last version to this version, you can see the red items. Some of the coding still sticks, though, and I'm not sure what it means. When you have like a text change or a symbol change. We'll clean that up though for...
Oh yeah, it's working. Anything else, Mimi?
No.
Did you, you made that statement about the site plan. Was that in the form of a question or you want to see how the rest of the board speaks to that? Seems like council was all right with it, the way it is.
Yeah. Well, we... when we originally decided to pose the question to the planning board, we hadn't heard from council, and as all the other board members have far more experience than I wanted to defer to the board to make sure that was okay as written.
Mr. Jenks.
What are the terms that would be different from the normal site plan review? And can they be made the same? I think it makes sense to have one site plan review procedure. And I know one of the problems right now is there are scattered references in the zoning bylaw that say if such and such is the case, then it's subject to major site plan review.
Oh, here it is.
And I think it would, at some point, if we pull all of that together and put it in the site plan review provisions, that would be the correct way to do it. So, but if there's something that is so different relating to this, maybe it wouldn't fit and we'd have to put it separate, but I don't know what those are, so it's...
Is it all right for me to say something? I could add to that. During the working group meetings, one of the questions came up was, do we really need to go to site plan review, and can it all be handled under the special permit process? And we thought that the special permit process had more of a general oversight of the project, whereas when you go to site plan review, it becomes a little bit more detailed in the specifics of the layout of the project. So one of the things that I had talked to Don previously about as well is, you know, there is the option that the applicant can ask to have the special permit and the site plan review at the same hearing, present at the same hearing. You'd have two hearings per se, and you'd vote twice. But in town council's review comments that were submitted to us today, the fourth bullet item, he addresses that that the site plan review process, you should just insert pursuant to 174-10, which is site plan review, so that we keep one standard for site plan review and just follow that.
Mr. Stein, any questions or comments?
I had a question about the definition, but is historical going to do a presentation first, or are we doing the run through and let them respond?
I think once we get through our comments here, okay. I was going to call on Chairman Hubley to see if he or any of his members here tonight wanted to say anything.
So town council was looking for some clarity on the definition for historic buildings. My recommendation would be to align it with the current demolition delay bylaw, because the spirit of this proposal is to basically, if I'm understanding it correctly, give people who are currently restricted under the current bylaw the opportunity to do adaptive reuse. And so if we revert to the current language, it's any building in whole or in part which was constructed prior to 1925 and is included in the Southborough, Massachusetts Historic Property Survey prepared by the Commission in 2000 with revisions and updates in 2015 or on file with the town clerk's office. I feel like if we're adding a different criteria, which is any other building or structure that is more than 85 years old, we've actually sort of created an overlay, a restrictive overlay inherent in this bylaw that really is outside of the initial intent and the effort on the part of historical. So I'm basically fine with all the other aspects of this form except the definition, and I would strongly recommend that it be aligned and essentially match the current definition. And if the historical or planning feels like we need to change both of them at a future meeting, then that's something that we can discuss. But I'm not sure that we want to sort of change the current demolition delay with this. And maybe someone can tell me I'm wrong. I'd be happy, I'm open to the possibility that I'm completely misunderstanding this. But if I'm not, then I feel like that's the best way to go.
One second, David. Mimi's going to speak. Yeah, come on up, David.
So this special permit stands alone. Although we do have a demolition delay, the purpose of this is to offer incentives to preserve historic buildings, not just those that fall under the demolition delay. And I know the Historical Commission will speak to this, but they feel strongly that putting a year in there is very restrictive. And if they were able to do it again, they wouldn't have a year on the demolition delay either.
So let's say hypothetically I had a building or a structure that was built after 1925, is not in the registry, but is more than 85 years old. And I just want to knock it down. So is this telling me, no, you can't knock it down because it falls under this new bylaw?
So that's a special permit. So it's at the owner's discretion of whether they would like to take advantage of this or not. There's no requirement.
Okay. I think that's going to be a really important point to get across, that if you own something that's more than 85 years old, they can scrape it. This is just something that you can do in addition or as an alternative to that, and it's not necessarily replacing the definition that's in the demolition delay. And I would,
correct,
let's just make 100% clear that we're all on the same page on this, because I don't want to go in front of town meeting and find out then that we were wrong.
Well, so special permits are always, I just lost my word, are not a requirement. It's not, it's, you choose to seek a special permit for certain incentives. You're not obligated to.
And that's the intent of the bylaw, is incentive, not like over-regulate, but to promote people choosing this path, but they don't have to choose this path, if I'm not mistaken.
Okay, so the building inspector is not going to point to this and say, sorry, you can't knock it down because it's more than 85 years old.
I don't think that's the intent.
But
I know.
Okay.
Bouncing off of what Mrs. Luttrell just said, the special permits, most of the special, if not all the special permits that we have now, are linked to something else, like, for example, site plan, the lower impact development special permit. You need to get that as part of the site plan approval. But in this case, this is a standalone special permit, completely incentive-based. And it's up to the property owner, the homeowner, the building owner, to decide if they want to try for the special permit or not. Kind of a little bit of a different, we're so used to getting these, talking about special permits as a requirement, but in this case, it's a requirement if you want to try for an adaptive reuse, but it's purely an incentive. Whereas the other special permits are additional requirements.
Okay, at light, then it makes a lot more sense in terms of the definition. So thank you for clarifying that, everybody.
David.
Okay, David Perry, 22 Main Street. Well, actually, Jesse, I think you've raised a very important point, which we definitely need to clarify before town meeting, because there's nothing worse than a conversation at town meeting between two definitions which conflict with each other and deal with the same topic. And I'm not even aware, can we discuss this tonight? Because I think this is vitally important. You can just get killed just on this issue of this darn definition. What is, and Ida wasn't involved in the demolition delay bylaw, well, I supported it, but what, again, go through the definition of what buildings fall under the demolition delay? What is that definition? I don't have it, you know?
So I can reread it.
Yeah, read it to us.
The definition is for historically or architecturally significant building is any building in whole or in part which was constructed prior to 1925 and is included in the Southborough, Massachusetts Historic Properties Survey prepared by the Commission in 2000, and then it says in parentheses, with revisions and updates in 2015, on file with the town clerk's office.
Okay, Jesus, that's a handful, which half of which I've already forgotten. It's architecturally, historically, and it's prior to 1985, and it's in some survey, which seems to be slightly different from, you know, this definition here is sort of the House Southbury Historic Building Survey dated such, and what that survey is slightly different. What was that survey again? A survey of something? What read it? No, but what is it? Just read it to me again.
Sure.
What does it say there?
In the Southborough, Massachusetts Historic Properties Survey.
Okay, well, the first question is, someone may ask, is that the same? Well, this is something we have to work out.
Well, the language is not identical, at least in the draft that
I have. No, it isn't, and it needs to be. I mean, there's nothing worse than having two definitions, is there, Phil? You know? I mean, they should be the same. Well, why can't they be made the same?
It would have cleared up my confusion.
In the historic, the proposal here, it's we're adding, there's a definition to be added, and the words are historic building. In the demolition delay bylaw, what words are we defining?
Historically or architecturally significant building.
So it's just two separate sets of words.
But are they the same survey?
Well,
may I speak to this?
Yeah.
Thank Michael Weiss on 189 Cordoval Road and a member of the Historical Commission. I think the piece that's missing here is that the definition for the demolition delay bylaw was made through compromise to be exceedingly restrictive as opposed to expansive, which is what we're trying to do here. So you do not want to copy this definition because you will limit the amount of people who are able to take advantage of this, which is why you also want this floating timeline, or why we would advocate for this. Again, this was a compromise wording that was made really almost as hard as possible to take advantage of because there were fears that this would be overly burdensome on property owners. So originally, the wording was proposed as simply being on the historic building survey or being deemed architecturally significant, which is another option that you could also pursue because that would give you the widest possible latitude. Because there are many buildings, not many, but a number that are on that have been deemed by architectural historians who comprise these surveys. We don't do this ourselves. We hire consultants to do this. And they comprise these surveys, and there are buildings on there that fall outside of this timeline and are deemed to be architecturally significant. And as time goes on, we revisit the survey and continually update it. So frankly, if I had my recommendation, it would be to simply say, is on the survey. Because this includes some 1950 structures and some 1960 structures. And as time goes by, we'll continue to be updated and evolved. Again, you know, we're trying to make this as open as possible and not as restrictive as possible. So in some ways, these two pieces of legislation are totally divorced in intent.
You get that. I'm glad you do. I'm not sure I do.
Well, that's a very important point that should be brought out when this is presented at the town meeting.
Oh, it will be.
Yeah, I'm glad it came
we
up
guarantee
tonight.
You.
So can I just ask then? You're adamantly opposed to changing the definition of the demolition delay bylaw.
We would love to change the definition of the demolition delay bylaw to make it more more flexible.
Oh.
But I don't think at this point that anyone on our commission wants to try to go back to town meeting to do that, having fought the fight we did just to get the bylaw passed. It's just fine for now. And by the way, you know, of all the things, just as a matter of public record, of all the permits that have come up in front of us in the last, how long has it been, Joe? 2 years?
Year and a half.
They've all been approved with exception of one, which we're working with the owner. And so it was not the, you know, the Armageddon that some people had claimed it was going to be.
No, well, I mean, I'm not questioning that. I'm just thinking about, you know, the town meeting floor and confused residents, of which there will be many, won't there? We know that, because I'm one of them. And, you know, I'm working on this. So it's interesting to hear you say that you would have no problem with changing the definition of the demolition delay bylaw. In fact, you sort of almost welcome it.
Well, yes, but we are not willing at this point to take this in front of town meeting. I don't think I'd have to discuss.
But you don't want to risk. You see that as a risk.
I don't. Now, who wants to open this whole thing back up again? Hard-fought battle. All I'm going to say is that Mass Historical would have recommended a rolling timeline for all the reasons that we've discussed. It really is not so much the definition of what constitutes a building, but the fact that we're locked to a single time period.
Hmm. No, and I totally agree. I agree with the rolling timeline and everything else. I'm just trying to sort of think, you know, I think I'm thinking of the same lines as Phil. You know, why don't we aim for simplicity here? You know, so residents and voters understand and maybe just amend the definition other bylaw as well, so they're identical. And then that removes all questions, doesn't it? You don't get in this endless conversation.
I don't think you'll get support from that from us. That's all we're going to say. No.
But I just heard you say that you would like.
In an ideal world, an ideal world. But I, you know, I can let our chairman speak to this. But in an ideal world,
I don't understand that, Michael. What is the problem with? We just said you wanted to. So what's the problem?
David, I'd like to do a lot of things. I'd like to, you know, take off
to. Just one line. So what is it? It's the risk of someone standing up and saying they're opposed to what?
I'm just, that's not the subject here. I'm going to bring us back to the subject that we're talking about, which is this proposed bylaw. At some point or another, if the Historical Commission chooses to revisit this, that's fine. But I'm explaining to you the history of the wording, which was a subject of extremely contentious debate and was an agreed upon compromise that took a little about from what we wanted and took a little bit about what other people wanted. And so.
Okay. So you don't want to upset the so-called political compromise.
Exactly.
That's the issue. Okay.
This was a compromise piece of wording. Again, because it was considered that the demolition delay bylaw might be overly broad and to restrict its potential use. This, however, is a opposite intent. So when we meet next week, I would recommend changing the wording to be deemed architecturally significant and on the list that is continually updated by the Historical Commission.
Okay, so we make this definition closer to the one in the demolition bylaw.
No, you'd make this definition entirely of its own.
I
really do think that you need to divorce these two things from each other because they're just absolutely night and day.
Okay. I think the reason I brought this up is I was under the incorrect, interpretation that what this was doing was preventing somebody who had a building greater than 85 years old from scraping it, from knocking it down. And that's not what's going on here. So if this is not additional demolition delay or demolition prevention, and if that's completely not the point here, then I completely understand why they went with this definition instead of the one that's in the demolition delay bylaw. Because this actually does give more people, right?
Yes.
It's actually a wider inclusion of properties with an opportunity to use an adaptive, to go for adaptive reuse.
And it incentivizes.
So that's actually much better for property owners.
The argument is that you're widening the definition, so you're giving more people.
You're widening the definition, and you're giving latitude within the existing zoning laws in terms of square footage, in terms of all the things that have been laid out here, additional usages. It's a broadening of the base substantially. whereas the demolition delay bylaw was a narrowing of the base. So I really think that, and we will certainly make it clear at town meeting that this has absolutely nothing to do with restriction of property rights. We're trying to get you to do the right thing. If you want to just do the wrong thing and scrape your house, that's up to you, you know. But we're trying to get, you know, we're trying to preserve the historic fabric through incentives.
Listen, please understand, I'm not trying to, you know, I'm trying to play the typical role of devil's advocate. You know, that's all. I'm totally, as you know, I spent countless hours on this darn thing. So I'm very much in favor. I'm just worried about confusion on town meeting floor. And the very issue here is that you brought it up as a planning board member means that it's almost certain to come up on town meeting floor. So someone, our town planner maybe, had better be prepared with a handout or something, you know, to get rid of this issue, because it can destroy you, you know, if you're not clear.
I would recommend that the subcommittee, you know, prepare for a presentation that really makes it very simple and straightforward to the audience that the point that we've covered here, that it's not restricting, it's just an opportunity.
Yeah. But I would just like to say, since I'm sitting here, I mean, we have done an incredible amount of work. You know, I'm not talking about myself, you know, we've met a number of times. We spent countless hours, retyping. I mean, it's just a sort of a night and day version of what on January the 9th we had. It's really, I think, in my opinion, a really workable bylaw now, whereas before it was just a sort of a collection of ideas which didn't sort of fold into the existing zoning at all. Now it does. I think it does it very well. And I just don't want any sort of small blooming problem, you know, coming out of town meeting, undercutting it all, and that's all. And Aldo's made comments, I don't see any issues. He's raised significant issues at all. Seems to be very supportive of it. He's made some very sensible issues, which we sort of, are obvious, referring to other sections and so forth. So anyway, it's great. I mean, you know, we got one more meeting. I'm looking forward to it. We'll deal with that issue.
Mrs. Luttrell.
Michael or Joe, can I ask you, the survey that's referred to in both the demolition delay and this adaptive reuse, it's the same survey. So we should call it the same thing.
Yes, and it has an official title, which I think we may or may not be referencing properly.
Okay.
But it does have a...
Can you repeat, either say that yourself, Michael, or someone repeat what you're saying? The question was about the name of that survey.
The survey has you would think as a member of the commission I would know, has a very specific title, and we will make sure that it's referenced. At the time when we did the bylaw, it was on file here and at the library, but now it's actually online as well. And so you can look very quickly and see if your property is on the survey. So, but we'll straighten out the verbiage to make sure that that's the case.
So speaking of online, we've got here draft revised by working group on February 10th, which was Friday. Is this online?
Yes.
All right, so people can go on the town website and look at what we're looking at right now. And then, as a result of future meetings and possibly the continuation of this public hearing, this could be revised again. Mr. Jenks.
Yes.
Can we give a little more guidance as to where this resides on the town website? Is this under the planning board or?
It's closer with the agenda.
It's posted on the planning board website page in the agenda.
For tonight.
Two places.
Yes.
Thank you.
This bylaw is not unlike some of the others that the planning board has been involved with. Because this involves zoning, the planning board is a player with this warrant article. It also involves historic buildings, which there's a separate commission that are the experts in town on that. So it's a joint effort. Questions or work to be done relative to zoning it would be on the planning board's plate, and questions relative to history or historic or structures would be for the Historic Commission to address. So it's a joint effort. Sometimes when we're asked questions about the historic, we have to refer to the commission. And when the commission is asked questions about zoning, they would refer them to the planning board. And hopefully the work that's been done so far with the guidance of town council has combined those two into a workable bylaw. So we answered the question about it being on the website. Yes, Phil.
I believe you refer here to buildings that are architecturally significant or something like that. Yes, no? I'm just going to ask you who determines that.
I would suggest that we work on the wordage for this at the next meeting and simply decide either it's that it's going to be the buildings of a certain age or buildings on a list. Again, this was a leftover from the negotiations for the demolition delay bylaw, because originally the intent was, again, to broaden this out to be buildings deemed to be of architectural significance, and this related back to being on this list. And then the second qualifier of the age. It was originally and or in the bylaw. If they were on either architecturally significant, which is defined in the bylaw as a term, or on the list. And then that was negotiated out. So again, you know, this was something of a landmine of legalese. So if the intent here truly is to make this the broadest possible extent, I would just say the buildings that are on the historical surveys list, because that is the largest group of all.
So I think that's a good intent and a good thing to do. I think all Mr. Jenks was asking is who establishes what the criteria is for architecturally significant.
Well, we hire, the commission hires periodically for review, approximately every decade, and a consultant, an historian, who comes in and takes a look at, you know, what has already been done. And also with the work that we've been doing on the Main Street project, and what is the Cates thing called? Do you know what I'm talking about, Brad? The actual term for Cates, the process.
The form.
No. Well, anyway, it doesn't matter. So, you know, in terms of working on the buildings on Main Street and finishing the research that we're currently working on, that also has a specific title, which just escapes me. But so this list is updated by professional architectural historians once every decade or so, and is due. We were just talking ourselves, saying that maybe we should do this more on a every 5 year, every 3 year basis to keep bringing in new structures that, you know, that now have become historic. Okay. So, yes.
If I back away from this and look at the intent of putting this in place, am I correct in saying that it is to offer some uses to the owner that would not otherwise be available if the owner will choose not to tear the building down? Is that basically?
Yes.
What we're doing?
Yes.
Do you have somewhere a list of these new uses that?
Yes, it's in the bylaw text.
Well, it's scattered.
Well,
or are you talking about where it says art gallery floors?
Yes.
As you're reviewing this, would you take a closer look at what is already allowed as a customary home office?
I think Mr. Perry worked on that extensively. And
you've got, for instance, on that list, let me go to the existing zoning bylaw where we define customary home occupation. And it says uses that involve the exercise of artistic, domestic, personal, or professional skills. And yet this says a professional office is not allowed in the customary home occupation. I think it is.
Well, I think when they're talking about professional offices, they're meaning more than just one person, the homeowner, i.e. practicing his or her profession.
Three people. Under the existing, it's two. You're allowing three, as I read it. But under the
existing... I'm gonna hand this over to my colleague.
I don't mean to get you into the words. I'm just saying, can that part be reviewed again?
Sure.
Because... I think it's
Phil, I'm very glad you brought this up because we struggled mightily over this thing, you know, and that's why we have in the draft, you know, for the public to see on town meeting floor, we wrote out the whole definition of customer home occupation, and you know, added those words except as provided in this once in four. It's not six, it's eight, titled adaptive reuse. So questions came up, what is a customary home occupation? You just to look at the first page, there it is. As you say, it does say, in fact, where is that word? You know, artistic, domestic, personal, or professional skills. So in actual fact, you may be correct. We may not need six professional office. You know, what we sort of were fumbling about this. Maybe that should be, you know, I don't want to debate the whole thing to death right now, but maybe we should take that out. You see, this is why we had those two clauses. You see the two clauses, B and C. We have B, we actually put in, obviously, you're allowed customary home occupations, obviously. Everyone is, and this is the use of the portion. But what we do is we change it from 25% to 35%, and there's your incentive.
And
a little bit more.
Allow three people instead
of
two.
Yeah, and three, absolutely, you picked it up. Three people instead of two, and 35% instead of 25. So it's a modest incentive, but maybe significant enough to make the guy, you know, keep the building and renovate it. And then we had C, look at the wording there. So the following uses, comma, which are deemed to be outside the normal definition of customary home occupations, shall comply with all the requirements of paragraph B above, which is a customary occupation, occupy a portion not exceeding 35%, the same amount as described in paragraph B above, and should be operated by persons resident on the premises, same as a customary home occupation. And then we thought, well, God, what are these sort of things outside of a customary home occupation, which would sort of be nice, but without getting us into trouble? And so that's why we said, you know, is an art gallery a customary occupation or isn't it? It's sort of one of those gray areas. Obviously, you can be an artist, but are you allowed to have an art gallery? I mean, it's an issue of sort of thinking, yep. Well, so we just put it in. You can. You know, it clarifies it. Are you allowed a professional office? Well, actually, I tell you the truth, I agree with you. It's pretty darn obvious you are. If you're a professional, like you are a lawyer, or me an architect, obviously I'm allowed to have an architect's office and two employees in my house. And you're allowed to have a lawyer's office with two employees in your house, and you're an engineer, and you're allowed to have an engineer's office with two employees in your house. This is a standard across, you know, Southborough, and probably every other municipality in Massachusetts, if not the USA. So, you know, do we need the word professional office in there? Why did we put it in? I can't remember the conversation. You know, to allay any doubt, was that the, why did we do it? You know, I can't remember right now. It was,
I think so. We wanted to just make sure they knew that
they
could do that.
We sort of wanted to sort of allay any doubt, really. It wasn't, it was sort of, it's kind of, but maybe we should take it out because it is sort of duplicating what's already in there. Maybe it's an unnecessary confusion. But if we took it out, we probably have to add it in down under two, where we have commercial / municipal buildings, which says, A, all use is listed in subsection one above. So we should probably move professional office and shove it down under two. Do you see what I mean?
Well,
so
if it's
that makes
allowed.
Perfectly, right? How do
if
we
it's
get
allowed in one, then it would be in two automatically, so it doesn't need to be added in.
That's right. Two is you're allowed all uses listed in subsection above. But I'm just going to Phil's point. Why the heck did we list professional office when it's already allowed, by customary home occupation? Oh, I get your point. Because it's allowed in
customary
home, occupation,
yeah.
Therefore it's automatically carried over. Yeah. Okay. Well, maybe that's the way to handle it. I mean, it's this whole struggle between clarity and repetition. Isn't it?
Jesse.
Yep. So if I found a home that was, say, architecturally significant as defined as being on the survey.
Right.
And I wanted to just turn the building, in effect, into a bakery subject to site plan review and such.
Yeah.
And the special permit and all that.
Right.
Am I to understand that I could only use 35% of the square footage because it's deemed to be outside of a normal definition of a customary home occupation? So I'm okay in paragraph C, but I shall comply with all the requirements of paragraph B, which is that it's only the use of a portion not exceeding 35%.
Right, exactly.
So 65% of that single family home I would have to not use
yes.
for my bakery business.
Yes, exactly. We don't want to open this up to questions on the floor. We're going to have, houses converted to 100% bakeries. Row of bakeries down Main Street. It's 35% of the floor area, and that's it. And you can always say no, right? If the abutters object, you guys say no.
That's pretty good to me.
Yeah, well, so that's why we did it. It's limited. So that's why we had this 35%. We're trying to be sort of reasonable, but we don't want to open the whole floor to sort of a flood of sort of undesirable uses.
Before I go to you, Sam, I'd like to go back to that definition again and the time. I don't have a problem with the definition, and I'm trying to, I hope, add clarity to and reinforce that the demolition delay bylaw is different completely than this. But both definitions refer to the Southborough Historic Building Survey, which I'll just call the survey. There is a clear title to that. We'll just call it the survey. So in the demolition delay, the clock on that was 1925, which was 92 years ago. So in this definition, it refers to a building that's listed in the survey or any other building or structure that is more than 85 years old. So even though it refers to the survey, and the survey identifies buildings that may have architectural or historical features, this definition, it refers to the survey, but because of the word or, there's really only one trigger in this. For a building to be eligible for this special permit, and that is that if it's more than 85 years old, which I don't have a problem with, but it should be made clear that even though we're referring to the survey, because of the word or, it doesn't have to be in the survey.
Right, absolutely.
It could just be 85 years old.
Right.
And you and it applies, which I think goes back to what Michael was saying, trying to find a definition that gives maximum flexibility to the property owners of any of these buildings or structures that is more than 85 years old.
Right.
It's much more open to use or applicability than the demolition delay. So I agree with clearing up, making sure that the survey has the proper title in both, but that it's understood that because of the word or, it doesn't have to be in that survey.
I have to ask a question here. So the implication here, Michael, is that in this survey there are buildings younger than 85 years old.
Yes.
Ah. Okay.
The answer is yes.
Yeah. The answer is yes. I wasn't aware of that.
Well, that goes to something that I believe is in the National Historic Preservation Act, which applies, you know, to all kinds of buildings, including federal buildings. Where a building could be not very old at all, but if something historic occurred in there,
yeah, right,
it could be governed by that act.
Right, a person could have lived there, a famous person could have lived there,
like you.
A famous event could have happened there,
like your house.
Well, did anything significant happen in my house? I'm not sure.
Former planning board member.
Oh God, yes, that's so significant. Right.
All right, we'll move on to Sam.
Sam Stivers, 7 Presidential Drive, advisory committee member, but speaking as a private citizen. First, I apologize, I got here late, so maybe what I'm going to say has already been covered. But to Mr. Jenks's point, I think it actually is extremely important to be able to communicate clearly. Here's what you can do today and versus here's what you can do under this bylaw. I think it is very fuzzy to figure that out in here. So I think that ultimately for town meeting particularly, you need to be able to go down a list of bullet points. Here's today, here's the new one. And I still think, and again, I apologize, I've not had time to spend a lot of time reading through the latest draft, but it looks to me like there's still not enough incentive in here to actually get a lot of traction for people who might want to do this. So again, I don't have specific suggestions now, but I'll think about that some more, and I think we got a little bit of time left. And I also see one thing in here that I actually cared about that didn't make it into this draft, and I'm curious what happened to it, which was the owner-occupied requirement. My concern about all of this stuff is that as a former zoning board member, I think people are very concerned about somebody buying a house and turning it into some sort of a semi-commercial operation in the middle of a residential neighborhood, turning into a rooming house or whatever, like the accessory apartment stuff in here, which I think accessory apartments are very important and useful. But I think there need to be some more boundaries around that than just leaving the door open for that. And I think owner-occupied makes a big difference. I've seen that calm the fears of neighbors when these kinds of things have been proposed, and I think it's not too hard to define that. I actually suggested some language in the last draft that I thought did a pretty good job of defining what that means. And for me, again, there is a lot of my observation is there's a lot of concern from folks who are involved in things like this in smaller scale, like, again, just simple accessory apartments. Say, I don't want a rooming house in my neighborhood, so I don't want a place where, you know, transients are going to come through and new person is living there every month kind of thing, and who's coming through there. So I think that's a real concern that people have, and I think that you're likely to hear something like that at town meeting if you don't have a way to protect against that. I think owner-occupied gives you that. So I will spend a little more time looking at this and offer some more suggestions. It's my understanding you're going to form a subcommittee to take the next pass at this. Is that correct?
We did that earlier.
Okay. So when is that committee going to meet next? Has that been determined?
I will be meeting Tuesday the 21st at 4 p.m.
At the
Historic Museum.
Is that a public meeting? Or?
Yes.
Oh, okay. Mm. Not clear that I will have time before then, but I will get some more comments in. Thank you.
If I could look, because Sam did put that in, and we did discuss this at length. But there were several reasons why we didn't include your you know, your whole definition of home occupied. Because if you look at, you know, the definition of home, for instance, customary home occupation, it says right in the third line down, by persons resident therein.
Well, again, there's a distinction between resident and owner, and that's an important one, I think. So,
as opposed to,
yeah, somebody who buys it and rents it out, rents the home out to somebody. So, anyway, okay. I will provide more.
I see. All right. So that just so we understand you, though. So you're distinguishing a resident. Oh, okay. I'm a little bit confused here because all of these uses have to be occupied. You know, have to be run by a person resident in
right.
the building.
Yeah. But it could
well,
be
so what difference does it make?
It could be
you
a
have a right to rent out your house tomorrow and move to Florida.
Sure. But again, I think there is a different sense of responsibility, et cetera, for someone who owns the property versus someone who rents the property. So I think that's an important distinction. I think people are concerned about that kind of thing.
Okay.
I realize
right,
people may have different
understand.
Views on that, but I will argue long and hard that that's an important characteristic. Thanks.
Yeah.
And, you know, I will quickly say that there is probably, you know, I was on the other side of this issue in terms of maintaining that language. You know, there's a difference between being a resident and resident in. Very fine distinction. I don't know if it has any legal standing, but people can certainly be resident in a house without actually being a resident, meaning the owner of a structure. So. I think maybe Mr. Stivers is correct that that language needs to be, you know, thought about again. Because I know your argument was, and several other people, that essentially these were already permitted anyway. But, I think that in terms of, assuaging public apprehension potential, that that's not the world's worst conception. So.
Yeah.
Well, I would suggest, or at least open this in the form of a question, but I believe that if this goes forward without that owner-occupied, and then it is an attempt to add it at town meeting, it can't be done because it makes it more restrictive. If it's in there, if it's in the warrant, and people don't think that that's the way to go, then the town meeting can modify the warrant and make it less restrictive by taking it out. So if it's kind of a split, an even split as to whether to leave it in or take it out or add it in and then take it out later as an option, you can't add it in at town meeting because it makes it more restrictive. So you might want to think about that as far as the art and the science of dealing with warrant articles and possibly revising them at the town meeting. Any other questions or comments? I would recommend that the public hearing be continued. This was posted on the website today. Give the public an opportunity to look at it and attend a continuation of this public hearing, and also give the subcommittee an opportunity to get sworn in and meet and discuss the things that were brought up tonight, and maybe make some more revisions. Our next meeting is February 27th, and we have three public hearings that night, but they're all related to the recreational marijuana. So we do have time on the agenda to continue this hearing, and I would suggest that maybe go to eight o'clock on the 27th. Any questions or comments about continuing the hearing? Mr. Jenks.
Mr. Chairman, I move that we continue the public hearing on the draft historic reuse bylaw to February 27th at 8 o'clock.
Second.
Motion's been made and seconded. Any discussion? All in favor? 4-0. Public hearing is continued to February 27th, 8 o'clock. Thank you all. We have on our agenda other business properly before the board. First item is the planner's report. Karina.
Okay, tonight, relatively short. I just have two things to talk about. One is to update regarding the CHOPC process. The CHOPC members have scheduled a meeting for Thursday, this Thursday, February 16th. The agenda's been posted. Partially due to that, we've received a notice of intent to sell 10A Fitzgerald Lane, and we need to take action, determine whether the town wants to acquire the property or refuse to acquire it. So any comments on that? We received an appraisal.
We're way overdue to meet as a committee, and it's good that CHOPC's sort of been reinvigorated. I believe Ms. Faniff was reappointed. So we're looking forward to revitalizing the committee and moving forward with these very important affordable housing initiatives.
Anybody else?
What was the appraisal?
The DHCD, I believe, in an email stated that they valued it at approximately $202,000. But that could be subject to modification still, but I think that was the approximate amount. That was the DHCD formulated amount. I didn't look at the appraisal, so I can't say what the appraisal said itself.
And there is money in the Affordable Housing Trust, isn't there?
I don't know that yet.
So that's one of the advantages of having Ms. Faniff on the committee. She's also on the Affordable Housing Trust. So we will have all these answers and more moving forward.
Thank you.
Okay, the second item that I wanted to talk about is the subsidized housing inventory. And there was concern that we had submitted some units for Park Central, and I believe we found and determined and confirmed, at least on the town's behalf, that there are actually more affordable units there than we submitted. So currently I have a request into the DHCD, our contact there, to find out what is the process to amend what we've resubmitted. And I believe that it's probably just updating the form and resubmitting it. It's a one-page form with some backup. So she's out until tomorrow, so we'll wait to hear back from her this week. And that's all I have.
I want to compliment the town planner and Mr. Stein and Mrs. Luttrell on that. As we stated before, you know, the town planner has kind of picked up this and does the work on it, but it's a joint effort. And Mrs. Luttrell questioned that at our last meeting, and good thing you did. Next item on the agenda is the approval of minutes of February 6th, 2017. Any questions or comments?
Mr. Chairman, do you feel that it's clear from lines 26 through 29 that we came to a consensus that the outright ban is the first, you know, the primary article to be
put forward. And so we basically have a plan A and a plan B. I don't recall a third, a plan C. Maybe somebody can.
I thought plan C was if the ban doesn't pass, and then the warrant article to allow the sale of recreational marijuana in a certain zone, if that doesn't pass, then plan C is, I think as far as we know, relative to the state's position, that the sales could occur in many other zones in the town. I think the state still has some distance restrictions, but that's what the public will learn, that if it's not banned or if it's not restricted to a zone or zones in the town that we vote on, then there's far less control over where the recreational sales could occur based on the state law.
Okay.
So your original question was lines 26 through 33, and I think I read that part twice, but I thought that that because we haven't opened the public hearing, this captures what we talked about, but there's a lot more detail to follow, and I think when we were talking about this at the last meeting, which is what these minutes reflect, it was kind of our first pass at it, and not sure if there's much to be gained by adding a whole lot more detail, because I think once the public hearing is opened, there'll be a lot more info, a lot more discussion.
So at the public hearing, will we have the flexibility to discuss which article is put forth first in the warrant, and second, and third?
Definitely.
Okay.
But if I remember right, planning board doesn't usually have much input as to the sequence, the numbering of the articles, other than to be, if it's a zoning article, which one of these would be, other than to be quite confident that any zoning articles would be among the last at town meeting.
Where I'm going with this is I think it serves our intent that we not put forward an article that has allows sales in certain zones, hoping it will fail so that we can then move forward with our ban as a subsequent article on the warrant. That doesn't make sense to me, and I kind of, that's why I'm raising the question now, because from reading this, it appears that what we said was, well, we'll allow but restrict as the first proposed bylaw, but that's not what I remember from our meeting.
Read line 31.
But line 26 is, the first proposed bylaw will allow but restrict the locations, on line 26 and 27.
If I may, I think when we were talking about this, it meant first that we were talking at the meeting, like when we were discussing it, the first bylaw we were discussing here within the meeting. I see what you're saying. It looks like that's the intent to go 1, 2, 3, but I always thought that the idea was that the banning would be proposed first. I think this was just in writing down what we were talking about. We said, well, the first bylaw in the paperwork was the allowed with restriction. It was the order in which the bylaws were handed in the handout. That's why I think that it says first, second, and third. It was referring to what we were looking at in order, not suggesting that's the order of the articles.
So why don't we have our minutes reflect tonight that concern, and the board will ask the town planner to pass that along to, I think, I know Mark Purple has quite a bit of influence or some influence in the ordering along with town council, and pass along that desire that the ban, the warrant article to ban would precede the other articles relative to allowed sales. And then we'll have the town planner get feedback to us on that. But
and I can check the warrant list already to see if it's already put in the right way.
Thank you.
Because I have a draft. Okay.
Great.
I see what you're saying, the order.
Shall I proceed with a motion or?
Mrs. Luttrell.
Lines 59 and 60, it's an extension on the site plan, not, it says current permit for Zero Furman. And then on 60, the permit, shouldn't it be the site plan?
Oh, instead of the word permit?
Yeah.
Yep. You got that, Karina?
Mm-hmm. Line 59.
It's also on line 60.
Okay.
So it should say on the current
approval.
Site plan.
Okay.
And then the site plan has already been extended.
Is it the site plan approval?
Approval.
Yeah.
So has it had it been extended once or had it been extended twice?
It went through the cycle twice. Yeah. How do I hang it up? There we go. So it went to it got approved under site plan approval. That expired. Before it expired, they asked for a 1-year extension. You only allowed 1-year extension. So then they submitted site plan approval again with a certified statement that the plans didn't change. And then they extended it this next time. So it went through two cycles now. Or is that the end of the second cycle?
Mr. Stein.
I'd like to make a motion that the planning board approve our meeting minutes from February 6, 2017 as amended.
Second.
Motion's been made and seconded. Any discussion? All in favor? 4-0. I want to thank the town planner for, after just 3 weeks, really getting up to speed here on keeping us informed and doing a really good job getting the stuff onto the website. I know that the zoning articles, the historic and the recreational marijuana, our piece of these has to do with the zoning part. And as you can tell by the size of the audience tonight, how exciting and interesting zoning can be.
Yay, I love it.
Oh, Sam.
Oh, I'm sorry, Sam. I didn't see you behind the, we have.
What I've been waiting for.
Just have one person here tonight.
And he's hiding.
Yeah. Our next meeting is the 27th, but this, let's see, today, on the 15th, the ZBA has a Park Central agenda item that they've indicated will be continued to a date to be determined this Wednesday. So that's something that seems to be not sure how much discussion will take place, but it does indicate from the agenda and from an email that we received from their administrator that it will be continued to some date, most likely into April rather than sooner. Anybody want to say anything more about that or know any more about that? Very good. Mr. Stein.
I'd like to make a motion to adjourn.
Second.
Motion's been made and seconded. Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor? 4-0. We're adjourned. Thank you.